It's good to have material children. They started coming to our generation 24-6, and it's so good to see them. They're my good neighbors, and they always smile and ask me how I'm doing, and I don't know if I'm that old that they're worried or what, but but it's good to have them. And Aaron, can we, I don't think I know two of the people here. We could add the light of evangelism. Tell us who these people are.
This is my
okay.
And this is my Aunt Jill.
Well, it's great to have them. Great to have them. We had our light going this morning, too, so you'll have to visualize a light in our candle today. Today, we're going to be talking about the church. I've entitled the sermon, The Called Out. And if we are of the church, we are called out of the wicked world. And as we look around this world, it is very wicked. And supposedly, we're supposed to be light and salt so that we can attract others to come into the church. Let's read about that. Matthew 16:18. Matthew 16:18. Just one verse. This is how important the church is. And I tell you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell or Hades will not overcome it. And let's turn to Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2, 19 through 22. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Now, there's just a short definition of the church, but all these are very powerful about how important the church is. While he languished in Bedford jail, John Bunyan had a vision concerning the church. He saw a flame before a door and a man pouring water on the flame. But the fire could not be quenched, but he could not understand. Here he was pouring water on the flame while the fire continued to burn. Then in another vision, John Bunyan saw a second man standing behind the door who was pouring oil on the fire. Now this vision was very prominent in John Bunyan's life, because he knew that the church as we know it will never die. Nothing can put out the revival fires of the church. At no time does the New Testament pessimistically speak against the church. Now you can probably say, well, what about Revelation? There's some negative things said about the church. The seven churches, as you read the book of Revelation in Asia Minor. And the only ones that really came out okay in the report of Christ was Smyrna and Philadelphia. But as we look at these scathing reports, we can see that these letters prophetically tell us about the problems and the weaknesses in the churches that will be in the future as well. And we know that even though the church is strong and the foundation and the chief cornerstone is Jesus Christ, we know that there are always problems in the church. But we know that the church will prevail. It will never die out. Not even ISIS itself can destroy the church. And that is a promise from our Lord. But Christ spoke of the body of believers functionally under the Lord's leadership seeking to follow His commandments. That is the goal of our church, is simply to follow the Lord's commands. The New Testament speaks of the church as a spiritual body, an organism composed of all believers, as a local and earthly organization of the saints. At Worthington one time, there was a boy that came forward, and his name was Bernie Allbirn. And I don't know why I made this comment. I said, well, after I baptized Bernie, I guess we could call him St. Bernard. I don't know how I survived that. They gave me a rough time about that. But we are saints in the Lord. This morning we're going to talk about two different sections, or two different major parts of the church. Number one, the church is an organism. When we use the word organism in relation to the church, we are speaking of the body that possesses inner life and is not dependent on human organization. It is the concept of the church as being the body of all believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. The inner life of this body is the life of God Himself, imparted through the Holy Spirit, who lives in every believer. Many people do not realize that the church is a theocracy. It is not a democracy. And the reason the church has had so many problems is because man, in his organization, said this is the way the church is going to be, and they implement their own ideas into the church. The church is theocracy, and it is designed by the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're supposed to follow Jesus and not the organization of man. How did the church come into being? How did the church begin? In the study of the scripture, especially in the New Testament, it appears the church passed through three phases, all of which constitute its origin. It is customary to speak of Pentecost as the birthday of the church in Acts 2. And of course, you all realize in Acts 2 that Peter was preaching, and how many came forward? 3,000 people came forward to be baptized in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that began on the day of Pentecost. Furthermore, the election and conception of the church come before the election of God's people. Israel was chosen in Abraham, while the church was chosen in Christ. It is God's church in Christ. It is originated by God in Christ. It is dependent on God for the support of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said, and I don't really like this scripture, 1 Corinthians 3:9. This is what he says about the church. Paul does in 1 Corinthians 3:9. First of all, he said, you are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. And I thought the farmers would really like this illustration that you are God's field. The church is described as being a field that God cultivates and enriches so that it will produce fruit. The church exists through God and having eternally, and it will be eternally as long as always, because we know the church will never die. Nothing, as I said, can destroy the church. Second, we move from eternity into time, and we find although the church existed eternally with God, it came into foundation with Jesus Christ. For Jesus Christ is the bride of Christ. I know a lot of people like to say a lot of things that are not positive about the church in our world. But it's the bride of Christ. We've got to take care of this church. It is His bride. This phase of the church origin swings on two pivots. Jesus says, and we've read the scripture, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. The foundation of Jesus Christ or the foundation of the church is Jesus, for he is the chief cornerstone. Now, I know that we have a cornerstone out here, and I believe that it says, 1911, is that what it says? Out there, the chief cornerstone, and it's so important that the cornerstone is perfectly set. Everything else is plumbed around the chief cornerstone, and it's still existing after all these years. And Jesus is our chief cornerstone. Everything focuses around him. I love also Acts 20, 28. Take heed to yourself, to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you guardians to feed the church of the Lord, which he obtained by his own blood. Here Paul combines both deity and death of Christ in relationship to the church. He calls it the church of God, not of man. And the mystery of the church's existence lies in the fact that it was purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. And Jesus adds power to his death when he arose from the dead, sealing the transaction forever. Therefore, in time, Jesus founded the church, which has already existed in God's mind from the very beginning. And he purchased it with his deity, his death, and his resurrection. What an important act of security that the church has through the Jesus Christ. Now, after what I've just already said, I hope that you will feel that, yeah, the church is very important. And the church here at Liscombe is very, very important. I've said it once and I've said it again, that we need a church in Liscombe. And we're doing everything that we possibly can to get the church to grow, because it is the salvation of Liscombe and its surrounding communities. And so we must stand strong in the Lord. We must stand strong in the church. And we must do everything that we possibly can to make this church grow. It is that important. You know, I've said a lot of important things about the church already, but a lot of people excuse themselves from the church. I don't need to go to church. Come on. It's a real effort for me to get up and go to church. When I was in the quartet, we had a song called Excuses, Excuses. And it just lists a number of excuses that people give for not attending church. The other day, I saw a person that I knew, and they had a child. And I said, we would love to have your child come to our vacation Bible school. And the mother looked at me and said, well, he really can't come. He's got Taekwondo on that night, and he will not be able to attend. Well, I thought to myself, it should have been, and I smiled, but I said, it should have been Taekwondo. That's what should have happened, because nothing, especially Taekwondo, does not compare to the church.